Hello everyone, welcome to lesson 35 of our GoLang course. In this lesson, we are going to learn how functions are treated as first-class citizens in Go. So let's get started. As I have already mentioned, functions are first-class citizens in Go. This means in Go, functions are treated like any other data, such as integers or strings. You can assign a function to a variable just like you would do with a number or a string or any other value. This means you can store a function in a variable and use it later. You can pass a function as an argument to another function. This is a powerful concept because it allows you to create higher order functions, which are functions that operate on other functions. In Go, a function can also be returned from another function. This means you can create functions that generate and return other functions based on your input. First-class functions offer a lot of flexibility in how you structure and organize your code. It enables you to create more modular and reusable code. You can pass behaviors, that is, functions, around like data, allowing for dynamic and customizable behavior in your program. Now let's look at what function signatures are. The function signature in Go includes the parameter, number of parameter, the parameter type, the return type, and the number of return values. This signature is important for defining the structure and behavior of a function. Let's look at them with an example. Here, we have a function sum which takes two integer value a and b and returns a integer value. So, the function signature for this would be func that accepts two integer values and return int. Next, we have the printName function which takes a string value but returns nothing. The function signature for this would be a function that takes a string but returns nothing. Now, let us look at some examples. First off, we have an example of a function accepting another function. Here, we have sayHello which accepts the first and the last name as string and a function fn which has a signature of string as input parameters and a single string as an output parameter. The sayHello function, which is this, returns a string. Inside, what we do is we get the full name by calling the function passed to us. We call function with the first and the last name and then get the full name from it. Following that, we print the welcome message, which is welcome, the full name we got from the function call. In main, you can see here we defined full name, which takes two strings as input parameter and returns a string. This satisfies the function signature here. Inside the full name function, we just format the first and the second string as s1, s2. In some places, full name is written as last name first and then the first name. In that case, you can reverse the position of s1 and s2. You will get last name as the first value in the string and first name as the last value in the string. This provides you flexibility of however you want to format the full name. Then, we just call the sayHello function, pass the first and the last name and the formatter function, which is the full name function we defined here. And you will get welcome string in return, which would be welcome code learn. Now let's look at this with a practical code example. Here, I'm going to define a function double, which takes an int value and returns the double of it. Now I'm going to write an apply function, which takes another function as an input. Let's first write it and then I will explain you what it does. As you can see in our apply function, we are taking a function f which is of signature int as an input parameter and int as a return. Then we take a value x of type int. What we do inside the function is call function f with a value passed to us and then return the value. Let's see how this can be useful in writing flexible and reusable code. Here I am going to do result is equal to apply. I'm going to pass the double function we wrote and then value. Now fmt println the result. So what will happen here is we pass the double function to apply, which is f, and then we pass the value 5. So inside it, we call the double function with value 5, which is this one. So you should expect a result of 10 printed to the console. Let's run our program and see the output. As you can see, 10 is printed to the console. Now, I can write another function. Function triple here is very similar to function double. It takes a value x and then multiplies it with 3, returning the value. So instead of double, I can pass triple to it and we should see 15 printed to the console. As expected, 15 is printed to the console. So that's how you can pass functions around to another function, which helps with modularity and reusability of the code. As we discussed earlier, We can also save function values into a variable. I can define 5 times the function here, taking int value as an input and returning an int. And in there, I can do 5 into x. Now, I can do the same thing with apply and pass 5 times in here. If we run our program, we should see 25 printed to the console. As expected, 25 is printed to the console. Next, let us look at an example of returning a function from another function. Here, I have arithmetic operation function, which takes operation string and returns a function that takes two integer values and returns an integer value. Inside it, we are switching on the op string we passed, and in case if it's add, we return a function that adds two values. In case the operation string is subtract, we return a function that subtracts the values passed in. That's basically how you can return a function from another function. Let's now look at a code example for the same. Here, I define the function multiply by, which takes a multiplier and then returns a function of type int as an input parameter and returning an int. Inside it, what I do is I return a function of the same signature and with a return value of I multiplied by the multiplier. So this is how you can return a function from another function. Let's see how we can use it. So here, I created two variables that store the return value from calling multiply by. In the first one, multiply by 2, I passed value for multiplier as 2. So the return function is a function that should return the value multiplied by 2. And then next we have multiply by 3. Again, we call the multiply by function passing the value 3. So the return value of this should be a function that multiplies the input value by 3. So these two variables have functions stored in them. So here we call the multiply by 2 function and pass it a value of 5. So we should expect 10 printed to the console for this one. And then in the next one, we call multiply by 3, passing it a value of 3, which should return 9 as the return value. Let's run our program to verify the same. As you can see, we have 10 and 9 printed as we expected. So this is basically how you can use the return function or a function of higher order which works on an input and returns a function to make your code reusable. Now let's look at function type. While it's possible to pass around function signatures in some programming contexts, doing so can make the code less readable and harder to understand. This is because the signature alone might not provide enough context about what the function does or how it's intended to be used. In Go, you can use function signatures to define a custom type. This means you can create a new type that represents a specific kind of function. This can be useful for making your code more expressive and self-documenting. Here, you can see we have function signature that accepts two int input values and returns an int. We can define a type out of it. Here, I'm saying type operation is of type function that takes two input values and returns a single int value. Defining type based on function signatures like we did above makes your code more readable. It provides a clear indication of the kind of function that are expected to conform to that type, which can be beneficial for documentation and understanding the code base. Just to revise, as we have seen in the previous lessons, int, arrays, slices, these are different types. We also looked at struct, which is a custom type. Here we are defining another custom type, op, which is of type function that accepts two input values and returns a single int value. Let's look at this, how this can make our code more readable. So taking the previous example, I can say type multiplier is of type that takes in int value and returns an int value. Now, here I can replace it just with the type. I can say multiplier. Since we are taking multiplier as an input value, let's rename it to something else to prevent any confusion. I can say m. We can also change m to here. Instead of using the function signature, in this function, we just use the type, which is more clear and tells us what this multiply by function returns. Let's look at another example for the same. So I'm just going to clear the code here. So I'm going to write an arithmetic operation function that takes an operation or op string and returns the function accordingly. Similar to the example we saw in the slides, arithmetic operation takes an op string and returns a function accordingly. If the op string is add, we return a function that returns the sum of two input parameters. And if it's subtract, we return the subtraction result of the two input parameters. And in the default case, we also return a function that sums it. So here, if I want to create a variable that can store the return value from arithmetic operation, I need to do var perform of type this. And then I can do result, save the value from perform function passing 1 and 2. Then fmt print len result. Here, variable perform will have a nil value. So if you try to run the program now, you will get a panic. Instead, what we need to do is assign perform to the return value of arithmetic operation and pass add as the value. Now we can run our program and we will see 3 printed to the console. So here you see, as we expected, 3 is printed to the console. Now reading this becomes cumbersome because we have to write the function signature again and again. What we can do is we can define a new type operation, which is function that takes two int parameters and returns the int parameter. Here I can replace it with the new type we created, operation, and I can also replace this with operation. So as you can see, the code is much clearer now of what we are doing. That's the end of the lesson. Let's now summarize whatever we learned about first class functions. In Go, functions are treated as first class citizens, which means they can be used just like any other value or data type. They can be assigned to variables, passed around as arguments to other functions, returned from functions, and even stored in data structure. This flexibility allows for powerful programming techniques and design patterns. As we saw in the examples, treating functions as first-class citizens provide a high degree of flexibility in how you write code and organize your code. It allows you to use functions in a way that best fits the problem at hand, leading to more readable and maintainable code. This flexibility is a key feature of Go's design philosophy. Next, we looked at the function signature. The function signature includes vital information about the function, such as the type of parameters it expects and the type of value it returns. This information is crucial for understanding how to use this function correctly and for integrating into other parts of code. As we saw in the last example, by defining a custom type based on function signatures, you can make your code more expressive and self-documenting. This will lead to clearer, more concise code because it provides higher level of abstraction. Additionally, using function types can enable you to write functions that are more generic and reusable. That's it for the lesson. I hope you enjoyed it. If you have any questions, please feel free to comment under the video or reach out to our Discord server. I will see you in the next lesson. Happy coding!